Hello and welcome. In this video, we will look at a tower of a wind turbine. Why do we have a tower at all? It's simple. Otherwise, the rotor blades would plug through the ground. But the question of the right height for the tower is not quite so trivial. Of course, it has to be at least as high as the length of a rotor blade so that they don't dig into the ground. But the higher we build a tower, the more expensive the structure will be. On the other hand, the higher the tower, the better the wind conditions and thus the energy yield. When we build wind towers, they have to be withstand wide variety of loads. On the one hand, the weight of everything that is put on top of the tower, the aerodynamic rotor thrust, the vibration behavior and resonances have to be taken into account. Then there are questions of transport, because above a certain length, transport in one piece becomes difficult. What materials do we use? Steel, concrete, wood? The spectrum ranges from lattice constructions to tubular steel towers with and without cable bracing to massive concrete structures or combinations of thereof. Wood is also an alternative. The influence of the subjectively perceived landscape also plays a role. Lattice construction has again become an alternative to tubular steel construction for very tall towers, as the use of materials is significantly cheaper than for cantilever tubular steel towers. For tower heights greater than 100 meters, concrete in the form of hybrid construction is again more favored. Cantilever tubular steel towers are the most widely used type of tower. The construction mass and thus the costs could be considerably reduced with flexible towers. It is obvious to combine concrete and tubular steel construction, where the lower part is made of concrete and the steel tube is placed on top. Most recently, the trend towards ever taller tower at onshore locations has increasingly brought the hybrid construction method to the fore. But let's start with the tubular steel towers. Cantilever tubular steel towers are the preferred type of construction for wind turbines. The most important reason for this is the quick assembly at the installation site and, in the past, the comparatively low steel prices. Under favorable circumstances, the tower can be manufactured in one piece in the factory and bolted to the foundation at the installation site. However, the standard construction method preferred to date consists of several sections that are bolted together at the installation site. Larger towers are manufactured in up to 5 sections. The towers usually have a conical shape with a diameter that tapers from the tower base to the tower head. This saves weight compared to a cylindrical geometry for a given stiffness requirement. The towers are manufactured and assembled in 2 different construction methods. In the standard construction method of bolted sections, the individual sections are prefabricated in the factory with lengths of up to 30 meters. The sections are made of 10 to 50 millimeter fixed steel sheets. The sheets, which are then about 2 meters wide, are rolled into a circular shape on a rolling mill. The tower section is welded together from these sections. Material with higher strength is used for the mostly forged connection flanges and the foundation section. In the internal flanges are welded to the ends of each tower section. The connection to the foundation is made via a so-called foundation section, which is manufactured separately and cast into the foundation during construction. The tower is connected to the nacelle via the azimuth flange, which accommodates the azimuth bearing and it's made as a casting. The production of tubular steel towers up to a diameter of 4 meters is conventional technology. For tower heights over 90 meters, however, the diameter at the base of the tower becomes larger than 4 meters and the required sheet thickness exceeds then the usual 40 millimeter. The shaping of the sheets then requires special machines that are not always available in normal steel construction companies. In addition, road transport of the lower tower section is hardly possible due to the large diameter. For tower heights above 120 meters, tubular steel towers are therefore hardly an option. If the transport routes to the erection site are possible without major obstacles, or if welding on site is also possible, one-piece towers are occasionally used. This saves the relatively costly bolted connections. The base of these towers is often too large for road transport and is welded together on site from several segments. Here, the entire tower is welded together in a lying position. The entire tower is then erected with the help of a crane. The increasing problems in transport, the lower tower sections with diameters of more than 4.5 meters have caused for manufacturers to build the tower sections from prefabricated longitudinal plates instead of rolled and welded plates. This results in a polygonal cross-section of the towers. The elements are then bolted together. Let's move on to the lattice towers. Lattice towers were once widespread, then disappeared completely, and are currently experiencing a renaissance, at least in part. As wind turbines grew in size, lattice towers were increasingly displaced by tubular steel towers. Recently, there has been a renewed interest in lattice towers, especially in connection with large turbines of hub heights above 100 meters. One of the advantages of lattice towers is that they require less material than tubular steel towers. The construction mass is up to 40% less. This results in a cost advantage despite the more complex assembly, especially with rising steel prices. In addition, transport is made easier for very large towers. Disassembled lattice towers can be transported to almost any installation site. The disadvantage of lattice towers are the considerably longer assembly time and the higher maintenance costs. The effect of the landscape is also different. Seen from close up, lattice towers do not look very appealing to most people. From a greater distance, however, the filigree lattice structure appears much more transparent and begins to visually dissolve against the background. Light reflection, which is stronger in closed steel pipes, also plays a role. Proponents of lattice towers consider the visual effect from a greater distance to be less of a burden on the landscape than the more prominent tubular towers. Concrete towers were not uncommon in the early years of wind energy, but then disappeared from the scene. Today, concrete can be seen again. Concrete can be used to build very tall towers without unsolvable transport problems. Even the long construction time can be shortened today with prefabricated construction methods. In situ concrete is also used to build wind turbine towers. Here, the formwork is advanced in stages from the bottom to the top as climbing in sliding framework. In order to avoid the disadvantage of in situ concrete construction, the long construction time, various prefabricated construction methods have been developed in recent years. A proven prefabricated construction method for concrete towers is based on pipe segments prefabricated in the factory. The segments, which are about 3.8 meters long, are produced in the factory with conventional formwork and then placed on top of each other at a construction site and glued with a concrete synthetic resin mixture. The individual segments are provided with empty tubes distributed around the circumference into which tension cables are inserted during construction. Today, the prefabricated construction method is mainly used for hybrid towers, the upper part of which consists of a steel tube. As an alternative to the tube segments, a construction method with prefabricated longitudinal slabs has been used for some time. These longitudinal plates are very easy to transport and have no restrictions on the base diameter of the tower. The longitudinal slabs are a maximum of 10 meters long and about 3.5 meters wide. The tower is stiffened internally by tension cables. Today, one often sees the hybrid construction method. Here, the lower part consists of a concrete structure and the upper part then of steel tube segments. The low mass of the upper part of the tower compared to the concrete construction reduces the increase of the tower mass with height and thus leads to cost advantages. Building towers from wood has been a vision for a long time, and pilot projects have certainly been realized. Wood is available in large quantities and emits no CO2 during the production. This gives this type of construction a sustainability advantage already during construction. In addition, wood is easy to recycle. With regard to its properties as a building material, its great fatigue resistance should be emphasized, and the cost of a 100 meter high tower need not to be higher than a tubular steel tower, and with increasing height up to 200 meters, cost advantages could even be achieved. The lifespan is said to be up to 40 years with proper workmanship and effective surface protection. We will see whether this construction method will become established in the future. Oops, but that's not how it works. The wind turbine would fall over like that. Something else has to be under the tower, the foundation. The construction of the foundation begins with the excavation of the foundation pit. Then the so-called clean layer is placed, which consists of an approximately 50 cm thick and compacted layer of gravel. Usually a formwork is placed in the foundation pit and the steel reinforcement is braided before the concrete mass is poured. At the same time, the tower section and anchor cage is also placed. In most cases, the tower is founded with a so-called gravity foundation. The mass and spatial extent of which must be large enough to ensure the stability of the turbine. The size of the wind turbine and the nature of the ground are thus the decisive influence. A load case is the one with the highest loads during operation. This means that the maximum overturning moment for the foundation is determined by the rotor thrust during operation. Depending on the height of the groundwater level, or also due to the surface water penetrating into the foundation pit, a so-called button water pressure results on the foundation. This force can reduce the stability, and under certain conditions, this buoyancy force must therefore be taken into account. The required foundation mass can thus become even greater. Depending on the soil conditions, the foundations are constructed as shallow or deep foundations. The decisive factor here is the depth at which sufficient soil layers can be found to absorb the curing loads. Shallow foundations are round, rectangular, or polygonal slab foundations. This type of construction is also known as a standard foundation. The wind turbine manufacturers specify the properties and requirements for this standard construction method as part of their delivery specifications. In the case of the so-called deep foundation, the foundation plates are provided with piles that transfer the loads to load-bearing soil layers. Board piles or prefabricated driven piles are used for this purpose. The costs of the foundation are increased by another 30 to 50% by this type of construction. The tower loads must be transferred deep into the structure of the foundation. For this purpose, two structural components have proven their worth and are used in most cases. For tubular steel towers, a so-called foundation section is used in connection with the tower construction. It is practically the extension of the lower tower section into the foundation. The 1 to 1.5 meter long tube section is concreted into the foundation. The base flank of the tower is then bolted to the counter flank of the foundation section. A lighter and possibly cheaper alternative to this compact foundation section is a so-called anchor cage. The anchor struts between the flanks are pre-stressed again the hardening concrete. And now the tower and wind turbine can be placed on top. In the next video, we will see what is inside the nacelle. Many thanks.